The following podcast is brought to you by the folks at GoodPoliticsRadio.com.
Thank you for listening to the TalkStar Radio Network. For the finest and informative and interactive talk radio programming, it's the TalkStar Radio Network, available live via your local radio station and on the Internet at TalkStarRadio.com. Your feedback is important to us. Email us at TalkStarRadio.com.
Chuck Harder.
Hello there, Chuck Harder with you. Glad to be with you. And that said, we heard from the president and his commitment to rebuild New Orleans. He sounded very much like a combination of FDR and Lyndon Baines Johnson, and we will see if that happens. The problem is, one of the biggest problems I see is the rubble that has been left behind in New Orleans and the entire Gulf Coast. Now, we heard yesterday from a gentleman who believed that he was going to bring in machinery that would essentially grind the stuff up and make new materials out of it. We're talking today to Les Blevins. Are you there, Les? Do we have Les on the line? That doesn't sound very much like Les, does it? Plus, he's developed a new voice. Anyhow, we'll try to reconnect with Les. The problem is going to be, in my opinion, and I could be wrong, you know, I think you're going to see an endless stream of outside companies rushing into the area with the smell of money. Here in Florida, we are still not done rebuilding from last year's hurricanes. You can go into neighborhoods and still see the blue tarps on the roofs. There's just an awful lot that hasn't been rebuilt yet, and there's a lot of empty lots. There's many, many, many empty lots where homes used to stand. Okay, we got Les on the line. Les Blevins, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, for some reason we've got a terrible echo in the phone line. We'll try to fix that, but let me ask you a question, if I may.
Sure.
In your belief, what are you going to do with all the rubble that's left? One man said yesterday that he had a company and he'd bring in grinders and grind it up and run it through special machinery and wind up making new lumber and new boards and all that out of the rubble. What is your thought on all that?
Well, sir, I have just listed my company on the one of the websites, the McGraw-Hill construction website, saying essentially the same thing. I would run it through a process that I've developed.
What would you do?
Well, this process is portable. That is, the material would be brought to the road side, and the machine, the equipment, would go down the road, and the rubble, combustibles and non-combustibles alike, it doesn't have to be carefully engineered and sorted and all that, would be run through this thermal processing unit, and it's ash comes out the bottom. It would have some metal in it, which can be picked up by running a magnet over it. So this process would go right down the road as dump trucks bring that that's not already along the road to the road and tip it off. Then this process would process it into ash and non-recyclables, some of which would be like glass and cans and so on. The metal could be extracted and recycled.
What would you do with the ash?
It would be swept up right from the road top, the road surface, and taken to a monofill for ash.
What's a monofill?
A monofill is a special landfill for a particular product. It only has one thing in it. There's tire monofills and ash monofills and so on.
So then you would not recycle the material, you would combust it.
Much of it would be combusted. The metals would be recyclable. They would be recovered. I'm talking about everything, including from tin cans, from the municipal trash part of it, and also things like tricycles, bicycles, and all that sort of thing will just pass right through my technology, and the magnet would pick it up. And it would be loaded on trucks to go to recycling centers, metal recovery, material recovery facilities.
Have you decided or have you talked to anybody yet about what the long-term thoughts are about what they're going to do down on the Gulf Coast?
Long-term in regard to what?
Well, let me put it this way. When are they going to start some kind of cleanup, and who's going to be there first, and what have you heard?
Well, I think the Department of Environmental Quality is the one that's going to be the on-site managers of it. I'm looking to cooperate with them.
All right, hang on for a minute. We'll be right back with more on TalkStar. I'm Chuck Carter for the people. Different ideas on how to clean up the rubble and the mess on the Gulf Coast. Yesterday we heard from a man who thought that he would take down their machinery and grind it up and recycle it. Les Blevins says combusted. We'll find out more right after this.
Do you sell dietary supplements? If so, you may know that the Food and Drug Administration and the Federal Trade Commission regulate your sales presentations. Violation of the federal rules can lead to stiff penalties. You really must know the law. Fortunately, help is just a phone call away. Law Talk Incorporated has produced a CD series. 4-CD interviews with renowned attorney Jonathan W. E. Mord that explain the legal limits on sales presentations. The CD series guides you through FDA and FTC regulation, explaining the law that governs sales presentations, website content, and health claims, as well as global restrictions on supplement sales. This is a must-buy for network marketers and supplement companies alike. To obtain the CD series, call 1-888-RU-FREE-1. 1-888-RU-FREE-1. That's 1-888-783-7331. Call today.
Do you know what women want? If you're losing your hair, here are two things guaranteed to turn them off. A toupee or that hairsprayed comb-over look. But you hate your hair loss and you want it to change. That's where the new interactive and absolutely free DVD from Medical Hair Restoration can help. Various cures for hair loss, blood, radio, and TV airwaves. But the first question to consider is what has been scientifically and medically proven. Founded by Dr. Matt Levitt, Medical Hair Restoration has specialized in hair loss for over 11 years. With literally thousands of satisfied patients, you deserve to get your copy of their free DVD and find out the answers to your questions about restoring your hair to its natural, attractive condition. See the amazing before and after pictures of people who have gotten their real hair, self-esteem, and confidence back. Call to order your free DVD now. There is no obligation, just real results. You know what women want? To run their fingers through your real hair. Call 800-936-2823, 800-936-2823. For an amazing free DVD, call now, 800-936-2823.
Les Blevins is with AAECORP.org.
.com.
Okay. AAECORP.com. All right. Got that.
And they can click on any bottom of any of those pages and see the prototype of this equipment that I'm offering to bring to the cleanup sites. I believe the money that the government is spending should be used to create jobs in the cleanup area as much as possible, to employ as many of those that have lost their jobs as possible, And this is technology that can be manufactured close to the cleanup site using, for one thing, it would use empty containers like they use on container ships.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me just say this. One of the problems that this nation is facing is with what we call garbage, just everyday household garbage or waste. I used to live in an area where there was a giant burner, and what the burner did was it would take the household waste and spin it around and do some kind of magic with it and then run it into a furnace, and the next thing you knew it went up the smokestack and they co-generated power with it. The only problem was that there was always a little rain shower almost every day right around this burner because it would put puffy white clouds up in the air from the smokestack, and then you'd get little rain showers, and the rain, when it hit your car, would make spots on your car, little acid spots.
Yes.
Why is that?
Well, the rain washes it out of the atmosphere, doesn't it? It's like smoke in the atmosphere, and it gets washed out. The raindrops wash it out of the air, so then it accumulates on what the raindrops fall on. In our system, there isn't a smokestack. That is, when it's applied as a BTU gas generator, and the gas is then burned in a combustion turbine. There's no smokestack involved with that operation.
So what are you doing different?
Turning the material, that is a blend of biomass and municipal and industrial trash, into a BTU gas, and then firing the gas in a combustion turbine to generate heat and power. It's called cogeneration.
There's got to be something left over.
There can be minute amounts that can be scrubbed out if necessary. Depends on what's being put in, how much scrubbing, if any, is necessary. If it's like 80% agricultural biomass, then it doesn't have a lot of those contaminants in there. But if you're using 10% or more of municipal trash, then there will be. Especially in areas near population centers, there will need to be some scrubbing. But gasification is considered to be the cleanest method of conversion of this non-homogeneous material.
Anybody doing that now?
Yes, there are. Some of the big companies, I won't mention any by name, but some of the big companies offer gasification systems.
And are they in use?
Yes.
Like where?
I believe there's one in, let's see, it's I'm not sure.
I know in St. Petersburg, Florida, the one they have there is just a garbage burner.
Yeah, with a smokestack, probably.
Oh, big ones, yeah.
Yeah, and that's the part of the problem is the size. You start off by describing it as giant, and that's what the mass burn systems are, and they burn a high percentage, maybe 100% of municipal trash.
Right.
And therein lies the problem. They're so massive, and the material that's being processed is so heavily contaminated. The emission scrubbing gets to be prohibitively expensive. It negates just about all the advantage of using the renewable fuel source that is there. Distributed generation, on the other hand, uses it closer to the site where it becomes trash or where it's disposed of, eliminating a lot of trucking and eliminating bringing it all to a central location that has this huge smokestack.
Okay, we got to do a two-minute breather. When we come back, what do you do with the stuff like batteries that have mercury in them, perhaps, or fluorescent tubes that have mercury in them? how do you get rid of the toxic chemicals in these processes? We'll be right back with Les Blevins. Don't go away. More to come.
I'm sure you've heard the saying, when you get to the end of your rope, tie a knot in it and hang on. Margie Garrison was at the end of her rope. At the young age of 28, she was told she would be in a wheelchair in about 5 years. And then, when she just couldn't go on any longer, she met a doctor who said to her, "Margie, arthritis is the easiest disease there is to cure." Now, can you imagine Margie's joy after 43 years and thousands of dollars of doctor bills and pain medications that didn't work? Learn the whole story online at HealthStarProducts.com. That's H-E-A-L-T-H, HealthStarProducts.com. It's guaranteed or your money back, and you have a full year to decide. Look it up online for yourself at HealthStar, H-E-A-L-T-H, HealthStarProducts.com, and find out if what worked for Margie Garrison will work for you.
Welcome to Straight Talk with Dr. Barry Sears. Dr. Sears, there's a history of heart disease in my family. What can I do?
We know heart disease is now an inflammatory disease, not a disease of cholesterol. And therefore, the best way to reduce heart disease is to reduce inflammation. And the best way we have to do that on a long-term basis is take adequate levels of fish oils rich in omega-3 fatty acids, refined to make sure there's no toxins. Again, fish oils like OmegaRX. This will be really your drug for the future to keep heart disease and the inflammation that comes with it under control.
The best way to add essential omega-3 fatty acids to your diet is by supplementing with Dr. Barry Sears' ultra-potent, ultra-clean, pharmaceutical-grade OmegaRX fish oil. To order your fish oil today, call 800-962-0123, 800-962-0123, or visit cleanfishoil.com. Call now for OmegaRX fish oil, 800-962-0123, or visit cleanfishoil.com.
We're talking to Les Blevins, and he is at AAECORP.com. Les, what do you do when you when you're inserting into this burning machinery toxic stuff like fluorescent tubes for fluorescent lamps or batteries or stuff like that? Are you there?
Should not be run through this process.
Say that again, please.
Batteries and bulbs like fluorescent tubes especially and certain other things. There are certain kinds of foam that should not be run through this process.
What do you do with it?
They're special waste and should be handled with special equipment, and I'm not in that field. So I'm not able to answer very clearly what is done. I think batteries are generally sent back to the manufacturer, and the materials are recovered for conversion back into new batteries again. I think they're equipped to drain the acid, recover the lead, and just, you know, take it from there.
Okay. What about stuff like even flashlight batteries, how do you pick the fluorescent tubes?
You want me to respond to flashlight batteries?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes.
In the subject of flashlight batteries, they should be collected. Common sense tells you that normally they should be collected and transported in bulk to a special waste facility that handles those. In the case of a situation like the hurricanes, if you find a flashlight or something like that on the ground that you know has probably got batteries in it, it just should be tossed into a bin for that kind of thing. It shouldn't be intentionally run through my process, my thermal conversion system, but I will say that in the event some of that material does go through it, if it's a small amount, if it's a minor percentage, like 1% or less, it's not going to be a problem.
Okay, so what you would run through your burning machines essentially is the structural stuff that made up the houses and the buildings, huh?
Yeah, all that stuff can be processed through my technology, and if you have a front loader that's got a whole load of concrete blocks, they wouldn't be run through. But if the next front loader's is mostly wood and only has a few concrete blocks in it, my technology is tolerant of those non-combustibles. They'll just pass through it. They'll land on the road when it comes out the bottom in the ash, and then when the front loader comes down picking up the ash, they'll presumably go right with the ash to the landfill.
Can anything be done positively with the ash other than burning it? Can it be combined with something to make a road out of it or something?
Yes, it can be used for road fill. And I would suppose, I haven't done any studies on this, but I would suppose it can be used for levee fill. I think it can be combined with concrete and will actually enhance the strength of the concrete. I think it can be combined into the manufacture of fertilizer. It's potash, and potash is a component of fertilizer.
Right. Right. That's essentially what you get when you burn pine trees, isn't it?
Uh-huh.
So that's why a lot of times after there's a forest fire, the ash on the ground acts as fertilizer, and the next year you got a lush green carpet.
Exactly, yeah.
So do you think you're going to get any of these contracts?
Well, that remains to be seen. Like I say, I've listed my company on the McGraw-Hill Construction Katrina Recovery Information Center.
Right.
And I'm looking to make contact with companies that are wanting to make the equipment there and create the jobs there, and also the agencies, that is the state agencies that are tasked with dealing with this.
I have a gut feeling that unless it's Brown and Root and or Halliburton, you're not going to see many other hats.
Well, that's what I've been typically, that's what I've been up against. This I look for as an opportunity, though, to open some new paths to a little brighter future for everybody.
But don't you think that this is going to be a political deal?
Oh, of course. Yes, it'll be very much politicized.
And that means that unless it's Halliburton or Brown and Root, and Brown and Root is part of Halliburton, you're not going to see many other folks in there. What do you think?
Oh, I think the little guys will be in there.
Do you really?
I really do, yeah. Maybe they won't get the big, juicy contracts, but they'll end up doing most of the work, I believe.
And who will hire them, Brown and Root and Halliburton?
I look for local contractors to hire the type of operations and equipment that my company can offer.
Okay. Well, I certainly wish you well and good luck and Godspeed. There's an awful lot of work to be done, and I thank you for taking time out of your day, Les. Les Blevins, AEECORP.com. Thank you for being with us. When we come back, I watched the president last night, and I have read every possible blog that I can find on reactions to what he had to say from all the various, I guess you call them, critics, pundits, commentators, you name it. But when we come back, I'll give you my personal assessment of what I see. And then I'll tell you why I've got butterflies in my stomach, and the butterflies have teeth. And I'm not kidding. I'm worried. We'll be back.
The views expressed on this podcast do not necessarily represent the views of the folks at GoodPoliticsRadio.com. We welcome your comments about this podcast and would like to hear from you. This is brought to you by the folks at GoodPoliticsRadio.com.
Hi, everybody. Chuck Harder. We're back. I'm going to spend a few minutes with you just giving you my observations. And for whatever it's worth, I guess I've been doing this a long time. And I have a number of different nicknames. One of them is The Man Who Sees Tomorrow. Because very often I have made predictions, and I have been very, very correct on my predictions. What I am seeing and what I am hearing, and of course, like anybody else, I have a television set, but I have a method of, I've got more than one TV set, and I can watch all the news networks all at the same time, okay? And you get some ideas there. I can also go to all the wire services and you name it. I can review it at the newspapers and what have you. And you can too on the internet. What I see is something that has me very, very, very upset. And let me start back years and years and years ago with public policy. After World War II, the United States of America essentially rebuilt the world. The only country we really didn't rebuild was Australia. We rebuilt Japan. We had a massive involvement in different ways in China. Obviously, we rebuilt Europe. And when we did that, we very often had to make sure that after we rebuilt these countries, that they had an economy. One of the ways we made sure they had an economy is we gave them ours. And we gave them industries. The United States of America, at one time, had about, 10 or 12 major companies that made highly precision devices, i.e. watches and devices that use that kind of technology. Let me give you an example. When we were in World War II, they needed all kinds of very, very precisionally made devices. Everything from the Norden bomb sight to little motor gyroscopes and what have you. At that time, we had the machinery and the technology to do that. We had the Elgin Watch Company in Elgin, Illinois. We had the Waltham Watch Company. And we had many, 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 many more. And these were companies with very, very precision devices that could take a piece of metal and obviously make a watch out of it. And that's the kind of technology you need for miniaturized, especially if you're going to go into battle. We don't have that technology anymore. We gave it away. Then we had another technology called optics. We made every kind of lens and optical device you could imagine. Everything from super, super duper binoculars. We made wonderful microscopes. We made terrific telescopes. We made motion picture cameras. You name it, we made it, if it was optical or mechanical. We then gave that industry away. Bell and Howell was one of the largest American companies, Bosch and Lomb, that did optics and also mechanical and electronics. They're all gone. They're gone. Bosch and Lomb, I think, is still around, but they make contact lenses. But the core business that is so important, especially in defense, is now offshore. You want optics, you go to Germany, or you go to Japan. Or now you go to China. You want fine machinery, you got the same thing. I saw the photographic machinery business leave the United States in the late 60s and go to Japan. A company then by the name of Takeda in Japan took over what Bell and Howell used to do. What am I getting at? I read an article yesterday from, believe it or not, Holland. Holland. Next year, in Holland, they will be selling Chinese-made automobiles. And the man who owns the dealership for the Chinese-made cars said, well, so what? China makes our clothes and they make our shoes. Why shouldn't they make our cars? And that's what the man in Holland said. He thought he was being clever. He was, in my opinion, industrial strength stupid. He's just like the Republicans and Democrats here in the United States who used to say that cheap imported items were essentially a gift because they were so cheap. And then slowly but surely we lost factory after factory after factory after factory. And the jobs in the cities all went away. And the cities turned into what you saw in New Orleans. Permanent underclass Americans of all different colors of the rainbow. And they said, well, whatever happened to the white underclass in New Orleans? And the answer is, a lot of them moved out. They just left. They went out to the countryside. Why, I don't know, but they did. But here in the United States of America, of all colors of the rainbow, you have a permanent underclass. People who used to have jobs in the factories that we have given away. We gave them away under all the different deals over the years, whether they were trade deals or whether they were a rebuilding deal. You name it, we gave them away. Do you know where the largest leather-producing organizations are today? They used to be in America. You had giant leather plants in Chicago and up in the Northeast and also in Georgia and the Carolinas. Today you want leather, it comes from China or Pakistan. Believe it or not, that's where leather comes from. Not here in the United States. I guess what I'm trying to say is, how are we getting by as a nation? How did Bill Clinton do it? Remember, it was the economy, stupid? I'll tell you what might be one of the answers of what was once the Clinton miracle and what could now be the Bush miracle, and how for our children and grandchildren it will be a travesty. I'll share that with you right after this short time out on TalkStar.
Okay, everyone needs a little legal help along the way. Here's a website with over 10,000 do-it-yourself legal forums for all sorts of state and federal needs. Buying or selling a car or boat, power of attorney. Writing a promissory note. Making a legal demand. Now you can log on and have over 10,000 legal forums right there at your fingertips. Just go to www.chuckcartershow.com. On the homepage, you'll find the link that will take you to over 10,000 legal forums. These forums are designed to help protect your rights and to save you time and money. Just visiting the site with over 10,000 legal forums is interesting and informative. Each form is prepared by attorneys and offered with a no-risk, 100% money-back guarantee. So when you need legal forums of any kind, go to www.chuckhardershow.com. That's chuckhardershow.com. Remember, www.chuckhardershow.com, where you can link up with over 10,000 legal forums online.
Do you sell dietary supplements? If so, you may know that the Food and Drug Administration and the Federal Trade Commission regulate your sales presentations. Violation of the federal rules can lead to stiff penalties. You really must know the law. Fortunately, help is just a phone call away. Law Talk Incorporated has produced a CD series. 4-CD interviews with renowned attorney Jonathan W. Emord that explain the legal limits on sales presentations. The CD series guides you through FDA and FTC regulation, explaining the law that governs sales presentations. website content, and health claims, as well as global restrictions on supplement sales. This is a must-buy for network marketers and supplement companies alike. To obtain the CD series, call 1-888-RU-FREE-1. 1-888-RU-FREE-1. That's 1-888-783-7331. Call today.
Last night on television, there was a short spot, and there was one line from George Herbert Walker Bush Sr., President Bush Sr., and next to him was his newfound friend, Bill Clinton, and they were raising money for the victims of Hurricane Katrina. When George Bush Sr. was president, we had some slow times. Of course, we had some tough times when Carter was president, and Jimmy Carter did some things that I thought were absolutely asinine, one of which was giving the Panama Canal away, that was to bail out the New York bankers, and of course, he deregulated the airlines, and today in the United States of America, we have four major airlines in bankruptcy. And probably somewhere around 11 or 12 of them have just totally disappeared. Famous names like Pan Am, Braniff, Eastern, National, etc. Well, okay, so how did we get into this mess? Let's start with the Clinton miracle. After President Clinton was elected, he was going to fix the economy. Well, he got a terrific shot in the arm called Hurricane Andrew. Hurricane Andrew pumped somewhere around $26 to $40 billion into the economy that did not go offshore. Thank God. And the reason it didn't go offshore is back then, Schlage, Locke, and other people who made devices like locks and hardware and what have you were still onshore in the United States. Today, most builders' hardware, whether it's nails, door hinges, door locks, or what have you, are made in Mexico or China or some other country. We still, however, in the United States, do have some forest product business left. We do have some sawmills. We do have a little bit of a lumber company left. Our lumber industry. We do have a concrete industry left and concrete blocks, etc., etc. So what President Bush is going to get out of Hurricane Katrina is a $200 billion economic shot in the arm for the United States of America. For a while, even the people who make up the underclass, the permanent underclass, may be able to find good employment. But eventually, that will stop. After things get rebuilt, if there's nothing else to do, what do you do? If you can't go to the factory, and if you can't make consumables like shoes, television sets, socks, underwear, shirts, automobiles, computers, etc., if you can't make that stuff in your country, and if you don't make that stuff in your country, you import it. And if you import it, you have something called a trade deficit. Our trade deficit is billions of dollars. By the end of today, by the end of a 24-hour time period, we will have borrowed another $2 billion from mainland China, the United States of America. We will have borrowed another $2 billion from China. Now you say to yourself, how did that happen? Hey, wait a minute, we're the United States of America. Why, we're the greatest nation on earth. Are we? Do we launch the world's satellites? No. No, we don't. Well, then who does? Well, Red China launches a lot of the world's satellites. The old Soviet Union, Russia, launches a lot of the world satellites. And a joint project called Ariane from France launches a lot of the world satellites. I don't think the United States of America from Cape Canaveral has launched a commercial satellite in the last 10 years. I just don't think so. I think we've launched some military satellites and some weather satellites for our own internal use, but I don't think we have launched one commercial satellite from the United States of America that I can remember in the last 10 years. Well, excuse me. It was Bill Clinton and George Bush Sr. and George Bush Jr. and all of the other politicians, Republicans or Democrats, that told you, don't worry about free trade. Don't worry about a few sewing machines going offshore. Why, high technology will save the United States of America. Isn't that what they said? Isn't that what we've been told? That the United States of America will be saved by high technology. If so, wouldn't you think that all the rocket scientists, if there are any left, would all be at Cape Canaveral, busy, launching satellites, communication satellites? They're not. As a matter of fact, I've had many, many rocket scientists email me telling me they're unemployed. Some of them doing the darndest things to try to stay alive. One guy who is a former high-tech engineer and rocket scientist now runs a leather shop. I am not joking. He makes wallets and custom-made leather goods. Another man runs a shop that makes custom leather goods like saddles. Former rocket scientists. Now, you can't get any more Stone Age, ladies and gentlemen, than the basics of leather crafting like the 1800s or 1700s. I mean, that's really going back there. But that's what they're doing. Now, what about high technology? What about high tech saving the United States of America? Look at your home computer. Where was the monitor made? All of the cards inside, where were they made? Look at the microchips on the cards. Don't a lot of them say Malaysia and China? Look at the keyboard. Turn it upside down and see where was the keyboard to your computer made. And if it's a mouse, like a Microsoft mouse or what have you, turn it upside down and see, wasn't it made in China? When we come back, the highest of the high technology, gone.
And now we flash back to the year 1956. Hungary is invaded by Soviet troops to crush a revolt against the communist regime. The Suez Canal is nationalized by Nasser. Israel attacks Egypt. They're joined by Britain and France until United States pressure forces withdrawal. Nikita Khrushchev denounces Stalinism. And Eisenhower suffers a heart attack, but he recovers and tells the nation,
I have decided that if the Republican Party chooses to renominate me, I shall accept that nomination.
Adlai Stevenson was the front runner for the Democrats.
If the Republicans were to win this fall, who would be running the store for the next 4 years? The key man of the Republican future is President Eisenhower's hand-picked heir, Vice President Nixon.
I respectfully submit tonight, Mr. Stevenson just isn't in the same league with Dwight D. Eisenhower.
Stevenson got his party's nomination, but the Democrats were split over his policy on schools.
School integration has become a dominant theme, perhaps the most dominant theme, in the race for the Democratic presidential nomination. At Lincoln's tomb in Springfield yesterday, Roy Wilkins Executive Secretary of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, declared that his race should resent and reject Adlai Stevenson's advice, as he put it, to accommodate themselves to gradual enjoyment of their citizenship rights.
Eisenhower was overwhelmingly reelected. Stevenson only carried 7 southern states, but the Democrats retained control of both the House and the Senate. Flashbacks from the year 1956.
So as a nation, we've lost high technology. Your home computer and about everything that plugs into the wall inside of your house is made offshore in China or Japan or some other country, not the USA. Even your fan that you used to buy that was made in Chicago by Lasco is now made in China. It may say Lasco, but it's still made in China. Okay, then what's left? Let's go to what used to be science fiction. When we watched Star Trek and they opened up the little communicator that went click, click. Well, today you open up your cell phone and you've got a communicator. I can remember a Star Trek episode where they went to this alien nation and there was some kind of a square device that had no moving parts, and yet it contained somehow data of libraries of information. And they were astounded that this some kind of crystalline device had literally libraries of information and no moving parts. Today, that device exists here on planet Earth. It was invented in South Korea. I believe it's called a 60 gigabyte microchip. And I've been reading articles about it. And it can store more information than the old hard drives that we used to have for our computers. I can remember when hard drives were 5 meg. And then they were a gigabyte, and 20 gig, and hey, a 60 gig hard drive is a big hard drive. And now they have it on one wafer of silicon, essentially a kind of rock. And it was developed in South Korea, and it's being sold by Samsung. Was it developed here in the United States? No. But ladies and gentlemen, this is the highest of high technology coming out of South Korea, out of Samsung. So I ask you, when we rebuild New Orleans, when we rebuild the Gulf Coast, when we sweep up the sawdust, and we're all done building and rebuilding, then what do we do as a nation? How will we and our children pay back the loans of this rebuilding when every day we borrow $2 billion from Red China, which is a value-added economy? They do manufacturing, they do mining, and they do agriculture. As a matter of fact, that's where my frozen apple juice comes from, because we can't even do that here anymore. Think about what we are going to leave our children after we rebuild the Gulf Coast. And we leave them another $200 to $300 billion or $1 trillion of more debt. How will we ever pay it off if we don't make anything? If we don't create wealth like we used to. If we don't do something, who will? If not now, when? I want to say a prayer for all of our troops and those in harm's way and the victims of this terrible disaster. and those other victims still to come. I want to thank everybody up and down the radio trail for making it happen and TalkStar. I'm Chuck Harder, for the people. P.O. Box 150, Tampa, Florida, 33601. God bless America.
The views expressed on this podcast do not necessarily represent the views of the folks at GoodPoliticsRadio.com. We welcome your comments about this podcast from to you by the folks at GoodPoliticsRadio.com.
Thank you for listening to the TalkStar Radio Network. For the finest and informative and interactive talk radio programming, it's the TalkStar Radio Network, available live via your local radio station and on the Internet at TalkStarRadio.com. Your feedback is important to us. Email us at TalkStarRadio.com.
Chuck Harder.
There. Hi, Chuck Harder. With me, Dr. Adrian Krieg, and he also has a website, which is KriegBooks.com, KriegBooks.com. He's the author of 2016, The Last Independence Day, among others. Doctor, how are you?
I'm great, Chuck. How are you?
Well, I'm going to tell you. Physically, I'm okay, but I've got butterflies in my stomach that have got teeth, and I am terribly, terribly concerned about the future of this country.
Well, small wonder. The story of New Orleans begins in 1718, unfortunately with a Frenchman. Jean-Baptiste Lemonnier de Benville decided to build a city in a swamp. For the environmental goofs that are listening, that's called wetlands. And he built it in a triangle between Lake Pontchartrain, the Mississippi River, and the Gulf of Mexico. If that isn't a recipe for disaster, I don't know what is. And I think that's probably where your butterfly started from.
Well, what's got me really sick... there's a couple things got me very upset. I'll share them with you and then let you reflect on them. Number one, there's these TV commercials running, and there's George Herbert Walker Bush Sr., and he says one line, and then next to him is his new pal, Bill Clinton, who says another line, and they're passing the hat for the permanent underclass that those two men created. And George Herbert Walker Bush, of course, he and Reagan shut down every alternative energy program when they took office. And then George Herbert Walker Bush was the architect of NAFTA and GATT. Bill Clinton made sure it got passed. And here in my area, we've got 1 mile square industrial parks, some of which were 30 and 40 buildings. Every one of them is empty. And we've got permanent underclasses all around the United States of America. And these two guys are passing the hat saying, we're going to help the poor people. Well, they put everybody out of work.
Well, they certainly did. I mean, there's no question about that. You know, when we look at what the results have been just of NAFTA, which, as you very correctly stated, was begun in the first Bush administration and then finalized in Clinton and illegally passed under Clinton. I'm sure you realize that... NAFTA was passed as an executive order, which means that the president essentially created law, which he's not allowed to do, but that's another story entirely. But that the result of this has been the closing of over 3,000 manufacturing plants in the United States.
I think your number is a little bit low. There's a company, I forget their name, Transcom or something like that. They are a a company that facilitates the moving of factories from the United States to Mexico. They themselves claim over 4,000 factories have moved in the last couple of years from the USA to Mexico. That does not include the number that have moved offshore. I've talked to a number of people who believe that we have lost to China, Malaysia, and all the other countries somewhere in the neck of the woods of 25,000 factories.
Well, particularly with NAFTA, you could be very right, you know, because in 1996, first of all, you must understand that in the NAFTA agreement, there is a requirement for the Department of Commerce and Labor to report the condition or results of NAFTA for the previous year, and they have to do that according to NAFTA every year.
They don't.
No, that's right. They don't. 96 was the last year they reported. When Clinton got wind of what was in there, he had all the reports rounded up and shredded, and they haven't reported since. And in that last report, it was 2,480 plants.
Well,
that was in 96.
Yeah. About 2 years ago, I had a terrible accident in 1999 that really screwed me up for about 6 years, put me in a wheelchair, and I wound up having a couple of strokes, and it was just a terrible, terrible accident. But I'm climbing back. But to make a long story short, about 2 years ago on a good day, I wrote a letter to the Department of Labor and to the Commerce Department, and it was a Freedom of Information Act, and I asked them how many factories had been lost in the United States or how many factories have left the United States in the last 10 years. And that was about from the time of NAFTA and GATT passing to when I wrote the letter, somewhere in that neck of the woods.
And don't tell me you never got an answer, did you?
Oh, I did get an answer.
Really?
Yes, I got an answer. The answer is, that's classified.
Hey, if you want to have some real fun, ask them for a copy of the FTAA planned agreement or treaty. All you want was just, you know, the basis of the discussions that have been going on since, what,
Hang on, 90... Doctor. Hang on. We'll be right back.
Yeah.
Welcome to Straight Talk with Dr. Barry Sears. Dr. Sears, no one wants to grow old. What can I do?
The aging process itself is one of increasing inflammation. If we want to turn back the hands of time, we have to reduce inflammation in our brain, our heart, and our immune system. And the best way to do that is by taking adequate levels of pharmaceutical-grade fish oil, rich in omega-3 fatty acids, things like Omega-RX. If you take only one supplement, to reverse the aging process, this should be it.
The best way to add essential omega-3 fatty acids to your diet is by supplementing with Dr. Barry Sears' ultra-potent, ultra-clean, pharmaceutical-grade Omega-RX fish oil. To order your fish oil today, call 800-962-0123, 800-962-0123, or visit cleanfishoil.com. Call now for Omega-RX fish oil, 800-962-0123, or visit cleanfishoil.com today.
Do you sell dietary supplements? If so, you may know that the Food and Drug Administration and the Federal Trade Commission regulate your sales presentations. Violation of the federal rules can lead to stiff penalties. You really must know the law. Fortunately, help is just a phone call away. Law Talk Incorporated has produced a CD series. 4-CD interviews with renowned attorney Jonathan W. Emord that explain the legal limits on sales presentations. The CD series guides you through FDA and FTC regulation, explaining the law that governs sales presentations, website content, and health claims, as well as global restrictions on supplement sales. This is a must-buy for network marketers and supplement companies alike. To obtain the CD series, call 1-888-RU-FREE-1. 1-888-RU-FREE-1. That's 1-888-783-7331. Call today.
Dr. Adrian Krieg with me. He is the author of 2016, The Last Independence Day. Doctor, I was talking to you as to why literally my stomach is so upset. I know that after this nation spends probably, by the time it's all over with, it'll be $500 billion to rebuild the Gulf Coast. Don't you think?
I'm not privy to, you know, making a prediction, but I think you're probably quite right. It's going to be an astronomical amount of money.
Okay. You know, right now they're talking about it costing more than the entire Marshall Plan when we rebuilt Europe. Okay.
Well, I think that one of the problems is it's going to cost everybody money because the insurance carriers are already boosting prices and will be boosting prices for all of the next 2 or 3 years.
Well, you happen to live in the state of Florida, so do I. There are 22 insurance companies trying very hard to leave Florida right now. And you and I both know what has happened to home insurance in the state of Florida since the hurricanes of last season.
Yeah, definitely.
But that said, here's what's got me concerned. You know who Peter G. Peterson is, chairman of the Council on Foreign Relations, right?
Yes.
I'm one of the few people that, for some reason, he'll talk to on a no punches pulled basis. I mean, I can ask him questions, and he'll answer them. And he doesn't pull any punches. He was on my show about 2 weeks ago, and he's got a terrible worry. And, of course, I'm literally sick to my stomach about it. You and I both know that this nation is borrowing $2 billion a day from Red China.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. How do you think China got most favored nations status? They had a tremendous amount of residual T-bills and treasury notes and papers. And they went to Alan Greenspan. They didn't have to go to the Senate or the Congress or to anybody. They went to Alan Greenspan and they said, we would like MFN. And he said, well, that's not my problem. I'm a banker. I have nothing to do with that. And they said, well, here's what you have to do with it. We either get most favored nations treaty status, or we will dump on the market billions upon billions of U.S. dollars and cause the dollar to collapse. Do you remember how fast they got most favored nation status? I think it was like a couple of days.
I think it was a New York minute.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that is very worrying, and it's very scary. Not only do Chinese hold a lot of paper, but the Japanese hold a lot of paper. And they hold the paper to change the currency valuation between our countries, to maintain their currency at a low level and the dollar at a relatively high level so that they can export and sell at cheap prices here. And, of course, destroy our industry while they're doing it.
Well, first of all, we have very little industry left. And my late brother-in-law, who used to buy parts to build cruise missiles and ICBMs, told me he could not buy parts to build these devices within the United States anymore. He had to go offshore, Malaysia, China, Japan, etc. So we can't even build our own cruise missiles and our own ICBMs.
You can get a lot simpler than that. We can't build the A1A Abrams tanks. We can't build them because OSHA shut down most of the foundries, and the upper portion of the tank is a special type of casting made in a foundry, and we don't have any foundries left that can do that.
Anyhow, Pete, I agree. Pete Peterson. He and I started talking about the future of the United States. And he made the observation that the entire net worth of the United States, that's your house, my house, the road outside, the superhighways, the buildings, everything, the net worth of the United States of America is $40 trillion in today's dollar. And he said every year we lose $4, $5, $6 trillion bucks, either on or off the books, And he said, it won't be long, and we will no longer own our country. What are your thoughts?
Well, I was going to say, instead of $40 trillion, I was going to say $34 trillion. I'm going to throw you a curveball here, because this is really scary. The eight largest banks in the United States, six of which are located in New York City, jointly hold derivatives in the value of $34 trillion.
All right, Doctor, hold it right there. Let me do a two-minute breather. When we come back, I'm going to let you explain what derivatives are and why you're so worried, because those butterflies with teeth in my tummy are chewing like crazy. We'll be right back.
It's bad enough if you suffer asthma, but as a parent, the agony of watching your child struggling for breath must be agony beyond measure. What if there was a natural, effective, drug-free answer to asthma? You'd want to know, wouldn't you? Well, I've been reading up on a little-known clinical trial at a major hospital that suggests you can be rid of asthma, asthma symptoms, and sinus and allergy symptoms to breathe easily, calmly, and in a more natural, relaxed way. It's guaranteed, or you get your money back, and you've got 90 days to decide. Look it up for yourself online at healthstarproducts.com. H-E-A-L-T-H, healthstarproducts.com. You've got 90 days to decide if this program works for you. If it doesn't, you get your money back. Go to www.healthstarproducts.com.
Tired of losing in the casinos and being in the hole? Learn how to win at Blackjack with Blackjack for Winners. Call 1-800-214-7012, 1-800-214-7012. This is the DVD the casinos do not want you to see. According to Tommy Hyland, a legendary Blackjack professional, this DVD teaches an easy way to count cards and beat the casinos at their own game of Blackjack. It takes only three easy steps. One, basic strategy. Two, card counting. And three, money management. It's just that easy to beat the casinos at their own game of Blackjack. Order right now and you'll receive two instructional DVDs, 52 flashcards making basic strategy a snap, and a reference card you can take into the casinos with you. All of this for only $29.95 plus shipping and handling. Order today at 1-800-214-7012. 1-800-214-7012. Start learning to win at Blackjack today with Blackjack for Winners. 1-800-214-7012. 1-800-214-7012.
Dr. Adrian Krieg with me. His website is kriegbooks.com, KriegBooks.com. His latest is 2016, the last Independence Day. Doctor, I want to give you the microphone. First of all, explain, if you can, in the easy, over the coffee table or over the kitchen table language, of what are derivatives and the fact that there's 34 trillion of these things floating around and how they can go pop.
Well, the scary, and this is what's really frightening about derivatives, derivatives are nothing more than a crapshoot. That's actually all they are. Now, it's somewhat confusing or difficult to understand, but derivatives are the trading of profits, assumed profits, or projected profits on actual things. In other words, if I have a loan paper with a bank, and let's say that loan paper is for $100,000, and they loan me the money at 5%, the 5% is a derivative of the $100,000. Now, derivative trading is the trading of those percentages, not the principal, only the percentages of cast-off interest or potential interest or future interest on a mortgage or it could be anything. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, what's scary about this is if that mortgage defaults, or if anything happens in that mortgage, the derivative is completely worthless. There's no recourse to go after anybody. You can't. You know, because what you're doing is you're not trading on an actual issued thing which has value. You're trading on a potential future value of interest. And that's what a derivative is. And it's absolutely insane that these banks, these eight banks, are trading in trillions of dollars of these instruments. And if an economy was to just stutter, you know, and it's happened a couple of times. I know Swiss Bank at one point lost about $12 billion. I know Citibank has lost the same kind of amount, as has Chase. And the biggest holders in the United States are Chase, Citibank, Chemical, First Chicago, you know, the biggest banks in the country, Bank of America. And I do not understand what possesses people to have such intense greed that they would gamble with such extremely, extremely volatile investments. I don't get it.
To make this a little bit more understandable, a number of years ago in the United States, we had the savings and loan debacle, if you remember.
Absolutely. And 600 banks went under.
600 banks went under, you're right. And many of those banks, whether they were screwing around with derivatives or what, I don't know, but what the banks were doing is they were selling to the American public, to retirees especially, an instrument that was lovingly referred to as a lobby note. In other words, it was a piece of paper that was supposedly an investment and supposedly would return an interest amount of money to the investor, but there was absolutely nothing behind it to support it. It was just like going into the lobby of the bank, taking a piece of paper and writing IOU, and that was it, period.
Well, that's what derivatives are.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, exactly.
And if you watch TV, almost every day, you'll see these different giant banks, one of which is Wachovia, that has these ads for their different investment products. And if you very carefully look at the TV screen, you'll see at the very bottom, not FDIC insured. So here we go again with lobby notes. And I'm not saying Wachovia is the only one. Lots of them are doing it, right?
Right.
What happens if that house of cards goes down? Didn't we already learn that in California?
Well, you know, banking, you know, and fractional reserve banking is such a corrupt practice from beginning to end. You know, as a matter of fact, I'm working on a book called Money, which deals with all of these issues and fractional reserve banking and all. I mean, it's incredible. If any individual, Chuck, if you or I or any of your listeners did the things that banks do in the creation of money and in the way they run their business, we would be in jail in a New York minute. Bankers have a monopoly and they have a right to do these things under the laws the way they set them up. And it's just incredulous that, you know, that's taking place.
Well, it's just like in the state of Florida, you can incorporate nowadays online in about 12 minutes, but you can't be a bank or a railroad.
That's right. Of course not.
You can incorporate just about anything, but no bank, and you can't be a bank or a railroad. Look, when we come back from a little half-hour timeout for our affiliates, I want to go back and revisit your concern about the $34 trillion in derivatives. The fact that the United States of America has a net worth of somewhere between, as you put it, $34 and $40 trillion. That the national debt on the books, off the books, and the trade deficit. And at what point in time will the United States of America become Western China? Hang on, we'll talk to Dr. Adrian Krieg right after this. Dr. Adrian Krieg with us, kriegbooks.com, K-R-I-E-G-B-O-O-K-S.com. Look, doctor, the thing that's got me really, really just sick to my stomach is that, I don't know if you heard about it or not, but Samsung, the Korean company, has a new 60 gigabyte chip out, which is like something out of science fiction. I mean, it's a chip that'll hold 60 gig. That's like a hard drive. One little wafer. And, of course, it was not made in USA. It's made by Samsung. The point, I think, that's got me scared is that we have totally lost the value-added economy. We don't do mining, manufacturing, or agriculture like we used to. When you go to Walmart and you buy frozen apple juice that comes from China, our trade deficit gets bigger every day. Now, so I want to go and revisit, again, the net worth of the United States and why Peter G. Peterson and you are so concerned. Go ahead, please.
Well, it's basically very simple. You know, we have a total national debt of about $34 trillion. Now, you know, when you listen to the pundits and the twits out of Washington, they will say anywhere from $4 to $7 trillion. And basically, they are correct. It is from $4 to $7 trillion if you take all the offline items out of the equation. Well, that's dumb. That's like saying you bought a car, but you know you're not valuing the engine and the wheels. It just doesn't make sense.
All right, do me a favor. I don't mean to interrupt you, but explain if you would. We're talking about on budget and off budget. And,
exactly.
And let me try to distill it down. If you and your family have a pile of bills that have to be paid, and let's say for point of discussion, the electric bill, the mortgage, et cetera. Let's say that pile of bills equals $1,000. Okay, and that's all the bills you owe. Period. $1,000, and then your wife comes along and says, oh, honey, I forgot to tell you, I ran up $21,000 on the credit cards. But don't worry, that's not really in our budget because the minimum payment is only $50.
That's right.
So now, what do you owe? Do you owe only $1,000, your current bills, or do you actually owe $22,000?
I'll tell you, Chuck, that is beautiful. You hit it right on the head. And, of course, where this money is, that this money is lying in the Social Security Trust Fund, which is dissipated, the Highway Trust Fund, the U.S. Patent Office Trust Fund, all of these funds, I mean, and there are scores of them, and there's trillions and trillions of dollars. And what
explain, Doctor, that the money is not there, it's owed. Explain.
That's exactly right. What's happened is Congress said, ooh, the budget is imbalancing. Oh, look at the Social Security Trust Fund. They got billions upon billions of dollars. Let's just take some of that money and we'll give them an IOU for it. And what they've done is gradually and eventually they looted all of these funds right down to nothing. And what the Social Security Trust Fund, the Highway Trust Fund, the U.S. Patent Office Trust Fund, and all the rest have is a big stack of IOUs, and they don't count that in the budget. They don't count that in the deficit. You know, so you have that. Then you've got $34 trillion being traded in derivatives, which is a crapshoot. And let me say very, very emphatically that if 10% of these derivatives were to prove to be non-performing, which is a very likely occurrence, we could say goodbye to the entire monetary system. It'll be gone. So added to this, we have this astronomical trade deficit and these idiotic wars that are costing us billions a day. You really begin to think that either a fool or a clown is managing our national economic policy. If we just go and look at one guy, we look at Alan Greenspan. He's been head of the Board of Governors of the FRS for 18 years. And he has inflated the currency in 18 years by 72%. I mean, these things are really worrying. Because if that had been done since the inception of the Federal Reserve System in 1913, the dollar would be completely worthless today. Compared to 1913, what you could buy in 1913 for $1 today costs $22. You know, this is not good. You know, and I don't want to scare the hell out of everybody, but this is a really bad situation.
Well, it gets it's worse in that what concerns me is, and I talked last hour about how we have lost all technology. I mean, when I say all technology, I mean it's just flat gone. I believe the next Detroit will be Silicon Valley because of the fact that that technology has gone to South Korea, Malaysia, Hong Kong, Singapore, and, of course, mainland China. And the emerging power on planet Earth will be mainland China. When they're done with the Three Gorges Project and they get all those generating plants online, they'll even include, they'll manufacture even more. I read an article, I mentioned it the last hour, an article came out of Holland, an idiot over there, has a dealership. He's going to be selling cars in Holland made in China. And he said, well, they make our clothes and they make our shoes. Why shouldn't they make our cars?
Why shouldn't they make Dutch tulips?
The point of it
is, I know.
I mean, it's just, it is so simple. Thomas Jefferson said words to the effect, any nation that does not produce what it consumes becomes a colony.
Exactly, of the ones who do produce. Of the ones who do produce.
That's right. And Abraham Lincoln said, this was during the railroad boom, and I think I'm almost word for word here on the quote. He said, if we buy a ton of rails from England for $20, then we have the rails and they the money. If we buy a ton of rails from an American for $25, then we have the rails and we keep the money.
Exactly. But, you know, you were talking about technology. Now, let me tell you about a little personal experience.
All right. Let me do a two-minute timeout. When we come back, the personal experience, and then don't forget, the big deal of tomorrow, nanotechnology is already offshore. We'll be right back with Dr. Adrian Krieg. Hang on.
I know you've heard me talk about Margie Garrison, the arthritis lady, but have I told you about the time she was thrown out of an arthritis convention for telling the truth that most arthritis sufferers attending that convention didn't need the expensive and maybe dangerous drugs and treatments they were being sold? Man alive, did they hustle her out of there, pronto? This might not work for absolutely everybody, but if you get Mrs. Garrison's program and give it a try for a year and it doesn't end up ending most of your pain, ask for your money back. Look it up for yourself online at healthstarproducts.com. That's H-E-A-L-T-H, healthstarproducts.com. See what the doctors are saying about Mrs. Garrison's program and if this works for you or a member of your family.
Do you sell dietary supplements? If so, you may know that the Food and Drug Administration and the Federal Trade Commission regulate your sales presentations. Violation of the federal rules can lead to stiff penalties. You really must know the law. Fortunately, help is just a phone call away. Law Talk Incorporated has produced a CD series, 4-CD interviews with renowned attorney Jonathan W. Emord that explain the legal limits on sales presentations. The CD series guides you through FDA and FTC regulation, explaining the law that governs sales presentations, website content, and health claims, as well as global restrictions on supplement sales. This is a must-buy for network marketers and supplement companies alike. To obtain the CD series, call 1-888-RU-FREE-1. 1-888-RU-FREE-1. That's 1-888-783-7331. Call today.
Our guest is Dr. Adrian Krieg, KriegBooks.com. Doctor, you were going to tell us about technology.
Sure. I came to the United States in the 50s, and starting in 1952, I was involved in the machine tool industry. In the 1950s, the United States was the number one machine tool producer in the world.
Yep.
We had it all. From about 1960 onwards, I developed about 25 or so patents in the machine tool industry and in the nuclear technology industries. Eventually, I was forced to sell my company because we simply could no longer compete on the market. The government would do nothing for us. We had Navy contracts. The contracts went to foreign producers. We were told that the NATO agreements that were drawn up in the late 70s required the United States Navy to purchase their machinery overseas as well as domestically, and they had decided to buy them overseas. Our technology was much better. Our items were, in fact, patented, which our competitors were not. To make a long story short, in a period from about 1962 to 1986, gradually we were forced out of business. Every machine tool product that we manufactured is now imported from overseas. There is not one of them made here in the United States. The price has gone up substantially. The quality has gone down, and by the way, why don't I do patents anymore? I don't do patents anymore because it doesn't pay. If I get a patent in the United States, that covers me for the United States. The Japanese company will knock that patent off and sell it all around the world. I can't afford to patent that item in every damn country of the world. It's too expensive. So I just don't do it anymore. I just got out of the technology business, and I write books.
I know. I devised a system back in the early 70s that I tried to facilitate with Western Union, and it was a medical information system. Today, I got lots of copyrights, but I don't know how enforceable they are. We'll see. But today, everything that I was doing back in the mid-70s is being knocked off. But I think that the biggest thing that you have just mentioned is that years ago, a gentleman in Russia came out with a thing called the Rubik's Cube. It was a puzzle. After a handful of those Rubik's Cubes were sold at a fair someplace, within a number of months, they were on every toy store shelf for 99 cents from overseas.
That's right. Yep.
There's a little company I know that makes electronic devices, and they pour them into black epoxy so that you cannot take the device apart and knock it off.
That's a good idea. Unfortunately, you can't do that with machine tools. I'll tell you, this is funny, Chuck. In the late 70s, about 79, just toward 80, I had developed a new invention, and it was quite interesting. It had four patents on it. And it was a very complex device that deals with the cutting of pipe in saddle and angle configurations while maintaining a constant bevel for welding, whatever. It was very complicated.
Okay.
And we introduced the item at the National Welding Show in New Orleans. And we sold, I think, in the first year, these things were quite expensive. They were about $30,000 at the time And we sold about 25 or so in the following year. And all at once, we went to the welding show in Cleveland the year later. And guess what? There was a machine, every part of which was interchangeable with our machine, made in Japan. Every single part violated all our patents, our copyrights, everything, didn't care. We called the U.S. Customs Service. They confiscated the equipment right at the show and shut them out of the U.S. market. But you know what? They captured the world market. They had plenty of money to back them. They started selling these machines. We had exported some of these machines to the United Kingdom, to South Africa, you know, places where big mining or offshore drilling and things like that, Middle East. And they essentially froze us out of the foreign markets because they had no R&D investment. They simply copied the entire device, and they sold it and put us essentially right out of that business.
I saw Bell and Howell. I saw Bell and Howell essentially put out of business by a Japanese company that took every Bell and Howell motion picture device, motion picture printers, you name it. I used to have a motion picture lab years ago, and they just simply copied it. Item for item, and believe it or not, they sold them here in the United States.
Oh, yeah. You see, this is another reason I don't do patents anymore, is because if somebody knocks your patent off, then you have to go to court. And the process in our convoluted, screwed-up judicial system is that you will be in court for the next 15 years, and after you're dead, somebody will concede and let your heirs have a few thousand dollars. So, you know, what's the point?
Well, a good example of that was years and years ago, there was a tube made called the Image Dissector. It was the forerunner to the iconoscope and the Vidicon and what have you. And it was, I believe it was by Farnsworth. And Philo T. Farnsworth invented the image dissector tube, which was the very first TV pickup tube. And, of course, RCA immediately knocked him off. And Zworkin and Morton came up with the iconoscope, which was a knockoff of the image dissector. Philo went to court, and I believe it was 20 or 25 years later, long after he died, that his wife finally got a small settlement from RCA.
Oh, listen, do you know the delay windshield wipers? The guy who invented the delay windshield wipers, every car manufacturer in the world knocked them off. And it took him 15 years to get General Motors to pay up. And then by that time he was in his 80s. And then he passed away, and then gradually Ford played up and Toyota and all the rest. You can't win with these big corporations, but they have lawyers on staff.
Hang on. I got a couple of 10-year-old lawsuits I can sell you. Hang on. Don't go away.
The most famous television documentary ever produced was Victory at Sea, which was as noted for the swelling musical score by Richard Rodgers as the amazing footage from World War II gathered from over 13,000 hours of footage from U.S., British, German, and Japanese navies. RetroTelevision.com offers you 26 episodes of Victory at Sea, stunningly reproduced on DVD for just $19.95. The original 26 episodes are presented uncut with every note of Richard Rodgers' original score for just $19.95. Mm-hmm.
To take advantage of this offer, go online to www.retrotelevision.com. That's R-E-T-R-O, Retro Television, you got to spell out television.com. Or go to TalkStarRadio.com to get your set of Victory at Sea episodes for just $19.95.
How would you like to work less, spend more time with your family, and make more money than you have ever dreamed of? Now you can. Cindy is a mother of three beautiful children and used to clean houses for a living to make ends meet. She found out about EasyBiz23.com. Her first month full-time, she earned $2,500. Her income increased about $1,000 per month, and now she earns $16,000 a month. Tori says before she started her own business, she worked 10 hours a day in a high-pressure job. She wore out her car commuting back and forth to work. Now she makes over $100,000 a year in her pajamas. Go online to find out more at EasyBiz23.com. Order a free, no-obligation work-from-home training package. Shipping not included. That's www.EasyBiz23.com. Tracy, a restaurant manager who came home to be a full-time mom, made $1,000 her first month and was earning $5,000 a month just 6 months in the business. Get free information now. Log on to EasyBiz23.com. That's EasyBiz, the number 23.com.
Dr. Adrian Krieg, 2016, the last Independence Day, his latest book, KriegBooks.com, KriegBooks.com. Look, doctor, the bottom line is that I don't know how much time this country has left to be and to remain as a sovereign nation. But, you know, Red China makes globes now, and when you buy a globe that is made in Red China, the country of Tibet has disappeared off the globe, and Lhasa is now just a town inside of Red China. My concern is, when will the new Chinese-made world globes indicate that what used to be the United States of America is now Western China?
Well, you know, it is a very trying consideration, but the dream of our forefathers has been sold down the tubes by these politicians you mentioned earlier. I mean, they're selling our country down the tubes. These bums that we elect and send to Washington, they're selling our birthright. They're selling our children's lives, everything. And I would hesitate to say when this will occur, but if we have another national catastrophe like this hurricane we just had, Katrina, it may well be the thing that pushes us over the edge. And, they'll just own us lock, stock, and barrel. It's distressing and very upsetting to me. You know, I came to this country in 1952, and at that time, this was without question the greatest nation in the world. And it's very distressing to see this country slip into a third world status.
And that's about where we are right now.
Yeah.
And
that's where we are.
And you don't know that unless you watch the Discovery Channel and you watch the high-speed rail systems in Europe and the shining, beautiful cities. And a friend of mine just got back from Hong Kong and Singapore, and they make our cities just look like dumps.
Well, in my opinion, that's because of our social systems and because of the way we behave. I mean, the situation in New Orleans that took place at the convention center and the Astrodome, I mean, that more than typifies what's wrong with America. I mean, it's just the whole story of this country. I have friends.
About 30 seconds.
Yeah, I have friends who went to New Orleans, and they came back devastated. They said these people, they don't even say thank you. They demand, they want, they're all, most of them are welfare recipients. They're a bunch of bums.
Well, unfortunately, they have been created
Yes.
And
by us.
The permanent underclass was created. I used to live in an all-white community that also had a permanent all-white underclass that was also created by the welfare system.
Oh, yeah.
And the bottom line is none of that will ever change until the United States returns to become a value-added society.
Absolutely.
And I doubt if that will happen in our lifetime.
I don't think so either.
Dr. Adrian Krieg, thank you for being with us. Good luck and Godspeed.
It's been a real pleasure, and good luck to you, Chuck, and keep well.
Thank you, Beth. You know, if we don't do something for America, who will? If not now, when? Stop and think about it. All of you wonderful people who grow oranges, you better read CAFTA. What about your future? I'm so worried about the United States of America. God bless us all and our troops in harm's way. Please do something for the United States of America. If nothing else, register to vote and learn the issues. God bless you and God bless America. Chuck Carter for the people.
The views expressed